Yo. Yeah. Yes. Yes. Yeah, we're back in the London studio, jamming it out with a master drummer, as it goes. He goes by the name of Richard Spaven. He's brought along his trio and a special guest, who we're also going to introduce in a minute. But for those that don't know, this is a guy who has played drums for the likes of Jose James, Gregory Porter, Cinematic Orchestra, Flying Lotus, has worked with Mark the Clive Lowe. The list is honestly endless. He's going to be actually jamming out today with some of the live tracks from his new upcoming album called The Self. It comes out on June the 30th and via Australian label Soul Has No Tempo. He introduced himself back in 2010 via the ever brilliant Jazz Refreshed with his Fives EP. Yeah, without further ado, I think we're going to get started with what The Self, the title track. Yeah, it's called The Self. Yeah.
Take a breath and leave, watching my soul collide, and it's all right. We made it through the night. Make the best of me. You keep hanging on for life, and it's all right. At least your soul survived. What's my recipe to seek the courage to align, to align? The end is near sight. Versus the sound. What's up versus the sound? What's up versus the sound? Got no focus, forgetting my direction, yeah. Functioning but hopeless, yeah. Take the best of me, you keep hanging on for life, and it's alright that we made it through the night. What's my recipe, yeah, to seek the courage to align, to align? The end is near sight. What's up versus the sound? What's up versus the sun? What's up versus the sun?
And also introducing our special guest, Mr. John Rakei. Let's get up one more time, please. So yeah, as I say, we are jamming out with Mr. Richard Spaven. We're going to be finding out a little bit more about the influences and the stuff that made his album itself so cool and so great. So I guess we should start off by talking about the basics then. When did you start drumming, and why the drums in particular?
That far back.
We're going. Yeah, there.
That's a while. Why the drums? I was so young, I didn't have any choice in it actually. Like it wasn't like boot camp forced into it. I was just like pots and pans, and around a neighbour's house, they would always sort of get the pots and pans out for me, you know, and I've still got them as well. And it just sort of, it was just my dad who just saw it happen, you know, regularly enough that he was like, okay, for Christmas he's getting a little snare drum, you know, and it was like a little wooden toy thing. And of course I loved it, you know, and then a hi-hat came next Christmas, you know, so I sort of accumulated a kit over quite a while. And none of it matched, it was all like trash, you know, but I loved it. It's like, that was my first kit.
That was the intro. And how about, so Freddie Wells being your mentor, I would say, the guy that introduced you and told you about your technique, how influential was he as kind of like a first, you know, messiah
well,
teacher?
He was like my only drum teacher, and he was just like a dude up in Luton, you know. What was sort of interesting musically about him, he was a jazz drummer. Like I learned to play like this, like orthodox technique, you know, I don't know if you've seen that, but it's like for years, you know, this is how he taught me to play. And it was just interesting because he played in big bands, you know, like jazz orchestras and stuff. So I was like 8 years old, I was like, yeah, big bands, you know, this is where it's at, you know, when you're sort of too young to go out. And I can't say I was buying records age 8, you know, but it's like, so I was like, yeah, some Buddy Rich, some, see what's in dad's collection, and you know, whatever my teacher was into, I just sort of was like, I was into it, you know what I mean?
And so when then did you kind of find your own feet in terms of like music?
Well, I think that sort of happened in parallel with, you know, having lessons, and I was sort of learning to play jazz, and at the same time, you know, that puts you in sort of like youth orchestras and that sort of stuff. You're reading music and playing that sort of chunky big band sort of stuff. But I remember turning up, and I'd be listening to Eric B and Rakim, turning up to rehearsals like that where no one else was into that, or, you know, and drum and bass later on. And that just became a really happy balance of things for me. Like, of course they go together, you know, it's like, there was no difference. So I think that's where it started to, you know, there was definitely some albums like Run DMC and Public Enemy that still, like, you know, Big Daddy Kane, that like hit a level still when I think about it, because it was like a real influential time, like NWA, Eazy-E.
Are you listening then to obviously the whole record, but also the drums in particular, because they're so chunky and, you know, boom bap? Is that would you say that was a?
I would say on the whole, not.
No.
I don't single the drums out when I'm listening to something, really, in general. But it was interesting, just like the vibe of hip hop, like, and samples and all of that. You know, so closely related to jazz. And I guess that was a thing, you know. I wasn't into like digging or anything at the time, but I think that was I sort of made that link somehow, you know.
Yeah, man. And I guess kind of like fast forward a little bit then to the club and the club dance floor, because having now listened to the project multiple times, you know, it's very, very evident that the club dance floor, and in particular places like Blue Note, and well, Plastic People, for instance, and the various acts that went on there, how big an influence they were. But not, I just want to talk a bit about more on a spiritual level and kind of mentally what they did for you before talking about the musicality. So yeah, how important were those places for you?
Like Blue Note, Hoxton Square, Metalhead's Sunday sessions was like, I think I'm getting goosebumps just talking about it. It was like, anyone else go? Were you there? Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, it was just like, it was amazing. It was like the start of, you felt like it was the start of something, and it felt like it was at the cutting edge of this scene that, you know, no one knew what drum and bass was at the time. And the music was just so ridiculous. Like, and then hearing it on that system, I walked out of there with the same feeling that I would get if I'd just seen like an amazing live gig or something, you know, like when you feel sort of charged, like just inspired, you know, and you'd be in that place. It was just like, I'm getting goosebumps talking about it. It was amazing, really amazing.
Have you got a favorite drum break?
I mean, I'd have to say the Amen break. I mean, just because it's, you know, it's huge. And I have to name check the dude who played it as well, as G.C. Coleman, because we always talk about the Amen break and we never talk about G.C. Coleman. And if I got ripped off as hard as he did, you know, it's pretty heavy. Like, that break changed music.
Totally.
4 or 5 times. Yeah. Still is, you know. It's mad. Just from something he just put down on a drum kit one day without knowing. Mm. It's mad, isn't it?
Yeah, it's crazy, man.
Yeah.
It literally changed the whole game.
Yeah.
The whole game.
Yeah.
I guess, yeah, I mean, we're going to get into a track called Law.
Yeah.
Just now. I guess that is essentially, you know, drum and bass filtered through, well, through your brain, obviously. But like,
yeah.
Yeah. But like, yeah, you've obviously put your own twist on it, but you can hear the that it's most clearly in your DNA. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, it wasn't like a, it's exactly that. It wasn't like an ode to Metalheads or something, you know, but it's just like, it's all kicking around in there, you know, yeah. Like all them years, just collecting, you know, in a way.
Mm.
So yeah.
Cool, man. Well, yeah, this track's
we'll
called
hit it.
Law. Thank you. Lovely. Also, yeah, hello to everyone back at home. If you've just joined us, we are here with a man like Richard Spaven and his trio. He's previewing some exclusive jams of his upcoming album, The Self, coming out on the 30th of June. And yeah, that tune was called Law. Yeah, how did you go about, like, what was your thought process when you were going through the making of this track? Like, what were you thinking?
Me and Stuart play a lot together. Stuart McCallum on guitar, by the way.
Yeah.
There's no by the way about it. It's just Stuart McCallum on guitar. But we met on stage with Cinematic Orchestra a long time ago, and we hit it off, you know, and since then we've just been playing a lot more together. And if I'm up north, he's come all the way from Manchester. If I'm up north, we'll get together, do some writing together. Sometimes it hits and sometimes it doesn't, you know, we just try and create the situation to do it. And like, this was something, like, we went away from the session like sizzle sizzle, you know what I mean? And the actual groove took me forever to come up with it, and it was a real sort of commitment to sort of take it in a sort of drum and bass direction as well, which, I mean, that's just the groove, you know what I mean? It's not like I'm not trying to do drum and bass, if you know what I mean. It's just like, it's just a vibe that suits it. That's McCallum at his best.
Yeah, man, shout out
that tune, yeah.
I was watching The Hand and it was just like, yeah, man, that's like such a nice groove, man. But we were also talking about drum and bass previous to you playing that track. And now looking from a more musical perspective and the influence of Blue Note, I specifically look towards people like Fotech and Dillinger for their drum programming, which was just like next level.
Yeah.
So being in those places, how then from like more of a musical perspective were you taking stuff in? Like,
how was I taking it in?
Yeah.
Like, I mean, the thing is, like, if you listen to Fotech Hidden Camera, like the programmed drums on there, they don't sound like some lame 20-year-old program drums. They sound like the most finely tuned, in your face bit of sampler work that I've ever heard. And I kind of miss samplers, you know what I mean? Like, I feel like laptops, I feel like I can hear the difference, you know, a beat that's come out of a laptop versus, like, you know, those dudes, they knew those samplers like inside out. Like, they were just rinsing every last, they sort of rinse some soul out of them almost, you know what I mean? They were like an instrument in themselves, those samplers. And like, so when I listen to Hidden Camera, it's sort of the same now as it was then. Like, a lot of that is just sound-wise, groove-wise, it's just ridiculous to me, you know? It's just nailed it.
Yeah, totally. And talking a bit about Broken Beat, we're joined by one of the G's.
Here we go, a ledge.
Well, that does our cue, jamming the back there. But yeah, co-op as well, because for me anyway, that was like the perfect marriage of, you know, the jazz influenced virtuosity. Is that a word?
Virtuosity.
Yeah. And just pure London grit.
Yeah, know? Well, like, co-op was like a relief because there was me years earlier. Like, now the Blue Note's closed down, it moved around some different places, you know, and so I haven't, you know, this thing that I loved that I was just talking passionately about and getting goosebumps, it's all shut down. So then there's co-op, and I remember walking in there, it was like, we're back on, you know what I mean? Like, instant, like, that was more of like a drummer switch of like, I was just like, I didn't know this stuff existed, you know, and it instantly spoke to me in like drum language, you know. That was mad. That was like Bembe Segwe introducing me to that scene. And I, you know, to not have a clue and then just to be surrounded by it was just like, it was so good.
I'm so envious, man. I'm so envious of like those early days. Of course, now, like, we're lucky enough to have, you know, IG's still waving the flag and
just
we're back, do you know what I mean?
Yeah, but, absolutely, yeah.
No, that's great. That's amazing. I guess, how crucial, I want to talk a bit about Jazz Refreshed, who, shouts to the guys who run that, Adam, and, I mean, Jazz Refreshed have been totally influential as well in terms of reviving and keeping alive, resuscitating. No, that's totally wrong, because it was always there. But in order to just like keep the love of jazz influenced music alive within London, you know.
Absolutely.
And they were obviously responsible for putting out your 2010 EP too.
Yeah. Which I'm very grateful, yeah. Like, it was all enthusiasm that brought that about, you know, because I was sitting on a couple of beats and they were like, finish them off, we'll have them, you know, and without that, it was a bit of impetus to, like, to get it out there, yeah.
Mm. And then, again, moving fast forward to this project now, So Has No Tempo, putting it out. When did you begin to start putting it together?
How long? This record?
Yeah.
There's a tune with Jordan that no one's heard yet. It's called Stills. And it was like the first thing, and it just wrote itself. And then, I mean, that's like 2 years ago probably. And it just came out so easily. And then I met Jordan at exactly the right time for him to sing on it. And that, just the way that came around, suddenly it was just like, okay, album's on, you know what I mean? It was just like full on from that point.
So from that, it was literally like, before that, you hadn't really gone into it thinking I'm going to make an album.
It was all just rattling around the back of my head, you know, like, I think I made some lists, you know, I felt like I was like making that. And the first like thing that I did was that track. It just like sort of snowballed from there. It got a real sort of, it was the sort of blueprint to the how I wanted the rest of the album to be, like more in your face. The drums are a bit more in your face. Like the mix is just a bit more like, it's just louder and fuller and more present, you know.
So who's responsible for mixing the album?
Oh, it's just some geezer. Nah, he mixed the album. Malarkey mixed the album.
Yeah. Shout.
Robin Malarkey on bass and mixing albums.
Yes. These introductions are proper, like, singing into each other super nicely. Like. We'll practice.
Not planned.
But yeah, I mean, it does literally sound so full and so up in your face. I wanted to also talk about the idea of being an independent artist and, you know, the trials and tribulations of, you know, trying to put out a project by yourself, really. What would you say, like, are the hardest challenges of doing that for this project?
It sort of gets a bit lonely sometimes, and it gets a bit weird, like, punting your own stuff. Because when you make the music, you know, I'm only ever going to put stuff out that I'm really feeling, that I can stand behind, you know what I mean? So whilst you're making the music, that's what it's all about. When it comes to like pushing it upon people, it's different for me. I feel different about doing that, you know what I mean? I can be proud of it, but actually sort of presenting it to people and like, listen to my stuff, you know, it's like, I find that quite hard work, but like me and Eric have been working on it, and it's been hands-on and DIY, you know, so to do something like this is amazing for the project. And I don't know, you know, it still stands when I think about the music, I'm just like super proud of this record, you know, I feel excited about it. And you know, when the vinyl comes, I'll have a moment to myself where I put that vinyl on and turn it up, you know.
Yes, shouts to that, man. So yeah, if you're ready, we're going to jump into another jam, I think. Undertone is the name of the jam. So yeah, everybody at home, this jam's called Undertone.
Thank you.
Yeah, sick. So yeah, I mean, you got one, but yeah, I mean, so that jam's called The Undertone. Undertone, sorry.
Undertow, yeah.
Yeah, what's the story behind this one, this jam?
It's another McCallum writing session that went well.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, in fact, on the record, they were saving something. Jordan is singing on this, on the record. Mm. So, trust me when I say you have that to look forward to. I've got to say, actually, like, this dude, I don't know how this record would have turned out if I hadn't have met him when I did. Because he's on three tunes.
Yeah.
Three tunes. Like, it's... And his sound, like... You know, it wasn't like one track, oh, that's nice, featuring, you know what I mean? Like, we got involved and like, worked on it together. And he went in, you know, and it's like his sound and vibe that he brings to it is, like, has just, like, lit it up. Mm. So thanks, man. Wicked.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, I guess you're working also with, of course, with Jordan, as you say, working with Cleveland Watkins as well. A couple of collaborators. How did your relationship with Cleveland blossom then?
I mean, Cleveland Watkins, if you don't know, is like, he's a jazz singer on one hand and he's the MC of Metalheads on the other hand. And he sort of leads this double life. You know, a lot of people don't understand that he does both of these things. Mm. So we're going to do some shows with him, which is nice because we've still yet to do one. And for me, like being able to, we do some like drum and bass classics in the set, like some Source Direct and some of that 97 stuff, you know, like Amen Breaks and that. And so to have him emceeing on that is going to be a little circle complete for me.
Yeah, you know? Yeah, bringing things back full circle. That's incredible, man. And I guess, Jordan's going to join for this next song.
Yes.
Well, it's actually another collaboration, but from a different project, from Jordan's own album, Cloak, which came out in, last year, 2016. It's called Toco.
Yeah, this tune is how we met.
This is the meeting point.
This is it. Because Jordan brought this tune to me. I was like, I listened to it. I was like, what is this madness? I was like trying to work out how to count it, like how to vibe with it. Mm. So yeah, it was a good place to start.
Mm.
Yeah, don't ask me the time signature. do you actually know what it is, like off the top of your head?
No, I mean, you told me it after I sent it to you.
It's probably best not to think about it because we're about to play it, but... It's funny, this tune, because it was always, it started off as a production thing. And then I'm lucky to have musicians in my band who are stupid enough to, you know, take on playing it. So we've had a real laugh with this tune because it's sort of, there's something ridiculous about doing it live.
Mm.
So should we do Autumn Leaves instead? So yeah, it's just we'll try and knock it out, but this is how me and Jordan met. So it's nice to do it today and have him here and everything, you know.
Yeah, sure.
And see the madness that is Toco.
Mm, brace yourselves, Toco.
Well.
Thank you.
Like that. Can I get one more time for these guys, man? That was incredible, man.
I came so close. Toko's that tune. I came so close. I nearly threw my sticks in the air. I should have done it, right? It's on TV, you know. That's the so close.
I guess before we round up, I mean, people want to see this live and should definitely go and see this live. Those of you guys watching online, where can everyone catch you?
The next show is in Amsterdam on the 20. I should know this, doing stuff like this, you know. 24th of June, Amsterdam, and Wicked Jazz Festival, and then we bring it home, of course, Jazz Refreshed, for the album launch on the 29th. So, yeah.
Yeah, man. And then, of course, yeah, I mean, later on in the year, you've also got Jazz Cafe show, is that still?
Yeah, London Jazz Festival, yeah. Jazz Caf, and we've got this interesting residency in Helsinki, which is going to be interesting. Yeah,
so plenty of chances to see this guy wherever you happen to be. Yeah, I mean, well, thank you first and foremost for bringing this lovely music into our space.
Thanks for having us, Errol. Appreciate it, man.
No, honestly, yeah. The pleasure is all ours, man.
Oh,
we,
no,
we can go back
you.
And forth and do this, but no, for real, man. And yeah, one more time for those guys who may have missed it at home. The Self, Richard Spaven's album with the trio, including the likes of Jordan Rakei, Cleveland Watkiss. Who else am I missing out?
Chris Bowers is a good one.
Chris Bowers.
And James
Zoo.
Yeah.
Wow. It's like, yeah, it's a real like all-star ting.
Wicked.
So yeah, that's coming out on the 30th of June via Soul Has No Tempo, a Brisbane, Australia label. Yeah, any more shout-outs? Go on.
I just want to thank Stuart McCallum on guitar.
Oh, yes, absolutely. Absolutely.
My all-stars, you know.
Yes.
Robin Malarkey on the bass. And his new little keyboard as well, which he just bought, which I don't know if you... Did you see him play the bass and the keys at the same time? Did you see that? Because that's the madman that he is. Jordan Rakei, yes, as well. And I just want to say thanks to Eric Carcenti for hooking this up.
Yes. Yeah, well, thanks for joining us, man. It's been an incredible day. Hope everyone enjoys the rest of the sun that still happens to vaguely be with us. But yeah, until next time, it's been Boiler Room, it's London, Richard Spaven even. Yeah, have a good day.